Hello, everybody. So, welcome. This is Charlie from Real English with Real Teachers. It's lovely to be here. I am here with my special co-host and great friend, Harry. How are you doing today?
I'm very well. Thank you, Charlie. Great to see you. And hello to everyone who is here. I see you're all joining now. Hello, welcome back to Real English with Real Teachers. Of course, we're here to teach you British English, and today is a little bit different. We are doing a debate live lesson today, aren't we, Charlie?
Oh yeah, we've got to get our debate on. I just realized, have you got a coin? Because we need to flip for things, don't we?
No, I have no money. I'm a teacher. I've got a lid. I'm a teacher, so I have pens, so I can do that.
We could do that. Okay, so hello, everybody. The reason for these videos, if you have never seen one before, is for us to give you real English and for you to interact and engage in an active way so that we can hear from you and help you correct yourself where you need to. So immediately get on that comment board and tell us where you are from, and maybe tell us, well, what would you like to know, Harry, about our students?
Well, in the last lesson, I asked the students to describe their face. So maybe this time they could describe, tell us where they're from and what they've done today. What have they done today? So I've had two lessons today. What about you, Charlie?
Me the same. Yeah, I'm the same. I've had two lessons as well. I was a bit naughty, and this morning I didn't get to work straight away. I had a bit of a relaxing breakfast and an hour of relaxing.
Oh dear!
Don't tell the missus.
Yeah. Well, at least you weren't late to your class, because there's no excuse to be late to a class on Skype, is there?
There's no excuse, apart from the internet failing on you.
Yeah, that can happen. Although sometimes I have actually been, you know, a couple of minutes late to a class, because some students talk a lot and I don't want to interrupt them when they're speaking. So sometimes I'm late for that reason.
Very true. Yeah, got to be courteous. Okay, so we want to hear from you guys. Harry, have you got the comments?
Yeah, Felipe Amado has said, I just woke up and had breakfast, about to head to work. Okay, Felipe, thank you for joining us in this class. Hello, have a good day at work. Also, Ali Haydar, today I've studied maths. Or math, he said math. So you said the American math without the S. But in Britain, we say maths. Yeah. But math is fine.
Yeah, we understand it. We're not too ignorant.
Yeah.
Yeah, lots of people. Hello from South Korea. Harry, does your clock show the right time? I think you might be confused with Charlie. My name is Charlie. And my clock is actually correct for me, because I am in Germany. I'm not in the UK at the moment. I live in Nuremberg, Germany. So that's why I'm 1 hour ahead, but good spot.
Okay. Maybe for the confusion, Charlie, next lesson you could change your clock back 1 hour for the lesson.
Maybe I could. I'll write that down.
Okay. Ah, Cinnamon Studio, one of my favorite students from these live lessons, has said, believe me or not, or we would say believe it or not, but I've just got out of bed. You've actually woken me up.
Oh, wow.
We woke him up.
Okay, so I'd like to know where in the world he is. If he's from the other side of the Atlantic, then that's fine. But if you're our side, or even further towards Asia, that'd be a bit worrying.
Yeah. But was it nice to be woken up by us, Mr. Cinnamon Studios, or Mrs. Cinnamon Studios? Was it nice to be woken up by Harry and Charlie?
Yeah, strange question, but yeah, wasn't nice. Okay, so straight away, we want to explain to you that today is a little bit different, and we want to get you participating with us in a little bit of a dynamic way. So as Harry said, we want to do some debates. We got this off one of my students. You know who you are. So thank you for telling us to do some more debates. But within the debates, we want you to offer your own opinions throughout them. We want you to send some suggested phrases or words that you find difficult, and we will try to use them within the debates.
Exactly. Yeah. So if we, for example, if we were debating what's better, bananas or apples, we want you to give us your reasons for why apples are better or for why bananas are better, and give us any complicated words that we can use in these debates. Like you could put, oh, disgusting. I don't know how to use that word. And then Charlie could say,
I could say they're delightful.
Yeah, or disgusting.
What? Well, I was a little bit confused there. What are you wanting me to say?
For example, if a student doesn't understand the word disgusting and they write it down, you could use it in your argument against me.
Oh, I see. Yes. Yes. Sorry. I was focusing on the comments for a second. Yeah, I could say, oh, they're disgusting. What do you think, Harry? And then we can see if they can understand that. Yeah. Nice one. Before we go into it, let's just say that we are announcing the winner to the two free Skype lessons. So you get one from myself and one from Harry. And we are announcing the winner of this prize at the end of this lesson. So actually, if you have not entered in the last 2 weeks, then you can click the link in the description box and quickly enter your email to be a potential winner of today's call out.
Lovely. That was very exciting. There's one person I want to say hello to, Charlie, because she wrote me a lovely email. I think she was a Brazilian girl called Gabriela Yu, and she just said hello. So hello, Gabriela. And she sent me a picture of her with Princess Anne, with the Queen's daughter.
Wow. Wow. Okay. Is she an actual student of yours, or has she just met you recently and she sent you this photo?
Yeah, no, she wants to book classes, but she's had problems with her credit card. So she's just emailed me a few times and she sent me this lovely picture of her and Princess Anne. Hello, Gabriela.
Hello, Gabriela. That's a lovely moment to have to meet a royal member. Yeah, very exciting.
Absolutely. Okay, Charlie, what's our first debate topic?
Okay, so our first debate is, can men get away with wearing tight trousers? Can men get away with wearing tight trousers? So I'm going to try and show my screen.
Get away with.
Okay, so hopefully you can see this. Yep. Can men get away with wearing tight trousers?
Interesting. That's a very interesting debate topic. So how do we decide if I'm for or against on this one?
Well, we suggested that we flip a coin, didn't we?
Okay. So if you choose the correct hand, you are for.
Okay. I choose your left hand.
Correct.
You need to speak so people can see it.
Okay, yeah, it's here. It's here on the left. Correct.
Okay, so I'm for. I am for this argument.
Okay, so you think they should be able to get away with it?
Yes, yeah? I think they should be able to get away with it. Now, let's explain the structure of get away with. Harry, do you want to take it away?
Yeah, so this is a phrasal verb to get away with something. And it requires so two prepositions, away with. And that means to do something and avoid punishment or criticism for it. For example, if you commit a crime and the police do not catch you, you got away with the crime. You escaped punishment. And so in this example, if men can get away with wearing it, it means they will not be criticized for wearing very tight trousers. Tight is like this, no space for movement.
Exactly, yeah. I have a little bit of an audio problem right now. There's some very loud drilling going on upstairs, so sometimes I might have to make you speak for a bit longer than normal, Harry.
Oh, it sounds fine. I honestly, you can hardly hear it. I can barely hear it.
Yeah, that's when it's quiet. It does get a bit louder. But yeah, let's carry on. So that's to get away with and wearing tight clothing. So do you want to start your against point?
Okay. So I don't think that men should be able to get away with wearing tight trousers because it's very revealing. It's very revealing. You see a little bit too much. You can see sometimes the male parts, if you know what I mean. And that can be offensive to old people, to men and women who don't expect to see that when walking on the streets or even at work.
Very nice. Okay, so it's a little bit alarming to see revealing to see more than you might want to of a man. Yeah, is that right?
Exactly. Yeah. When you go down to the shop or to the post office, you don't expect to see the outline of a man's parts.
Or the meat and two veg.
Yes, the meat and two veg. Exactly.
Should we put that in the form? The meat and two veg.
Should I write it on the board?
Yeah, go for it. Go for it. So everybody, that is a slang, quite vulgar. No, it's not too vulgar. It's just a slang, amusing way of describing the male genitalia, meat and two veg.
Yeah, exactly. So the meat is, I imagine, the penis, and then the two veg are the balls, the testicles.
Yeah. Okay. I think we don't need to go too detailed anymore.
Yeah. Okay. Good.
Yeah. So that's a fair point. It's a bit revealing. My four point would be that it's a lot more fashionable to wear, and in my eyes, when you have more shape. And I think we should. Oh yeah, do you want to pause?
Yeah, sorry. No, I just couldn't hear you. Your the internet was breaking up. I didn't hear you. Sorry. Okay. Yeah, your audio was going away.
Okay. I said to repeat. I said that it's nicer to have more outline to your figure and to be able to clearly define the body shape. So I think it's nicer. Tight trousers.
Okay, yeah, because you do wear tight trousers, don't you? And I agree with you to some extent. Okay, so I agree with part of your argument there. But one of my friends here gave a very good opinion regarding this, and he said that actually you shouldn't wear tight trousers because it can affect your fertility as a man. So because they are so tight, it I guess it keeps your testicles too close to the body and therefore not cold enough to maintain your lovely unborn children in their ideal temperature.
It prevents your swimmers from swimming.
Exactly. It prevents your swimmers from swimming.
So I think everyone can imagine what we mean by that. But just to clarify, I will type it in the chat box. Prevents your swimmers from swimming. And we should actually share our screen for the replay just quickly. So there we go. Oh, present to everyone. Okay.
Prevents your swimmers from swimming. So your swimmers are your sperm, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So Anna has just said they should be getaway for wearing skirt. They should be getaway for wearing skirt. Thank you for that comment, Anna. We would say they should be allowed to get away with wearing skirts. They yeah. should be allowed to get away with wearing skirts. But yeah. thank you for that comment. Yeah, so we can wear whatever we want if we want.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, some people, Adriana B said, my opinion is it depends on the situation and the place the man will use or wear these clothes. And, you know, I do kind of agree with that. It does depend on where you're going, doesn't it?
Yes. Yeah, it does. I see it sometimes in the gym. People wear very tight gym and it's not the elastic ones. And I think, what are you doing? There's a time and a place. Like in a gym, you want to move, you want full range of movement. So, yeah. Mm. It's a bit embarrassing, actually, when you're wearing tight, skinny jeans and you cannot get over a railing.
Yeah. Like
if you need to get over something in an airport or in like a theme park, wherever you are, if there's a railing, a small railing, and you can't get over it, you look very feminine.
Yeah, yeah. Do you have to jump over railings and fences often, Charlie?
Well, all the time, because I'm a parkour expert, as you know.
Yeah, it's true. You are. Yeah. You said an interesting phrase as well, Charlie. You said there's a time and a place.
Okay. A time and a place. Yeah. So it means to have a specific time and a specific place for an action or behavior. So if the place warrants it, if the time warrants it, then you can do it.
Yeah. Yeah. So if the time and the place is appropriate, then do it there. Yeah. Yeah. So we'd say it like, oh, come on, Harry, stop swearing. Stop saying bad words. There's a time and a place for this behavior.
Yeah, nice example.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that would mean that you can swear with your friends, but here it's not appropriate. So you can say exactly that. Come on, there's a time and a place for that.
Exactly. Yeah. So, okay. Would you like to go on to the next one, Chaz, or should we ask them who has won the debate?
Yeah, we haven't really got too far into it, but
some more comments.
Okay, let's read some more comments. I saw people when they run. I saw people when they run. You mean that when you see them running, you find it funny if they are wearing tight jeans?
Yeah, that's another reason why men, you know, shouldn't get away with wearing tight trousers. Because, you know, when they run and they're wearing tight trousers, you just see everything moving around.
Oh,
not very nice.
It's, I think Harry's nice. Looking quite accurately at this, aren't you?
Yeah, staring quite, yeah, with the binoculars.
Yeah. Okay, S. Hannah, yes, like ballet dancer, they should be allowed. Okay, so you're saying like ballet dancers are allowed tight clothing, so should we?
Yeah, but there's a time and a place. So they're practicing ballet, I don't think you can walk around the street wearing this type of ballet outfit. I think there's a time and a place for this kind of thing. So I don't think, even though it's fine during ballet, I don't think you can get away with this in public.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Another comment from Abira. Wearing tight trousers can be quite attractive to women. They also like to stare at some male shapes. One thing, Abira, you said it can be quite attractive. Quiet. So you used this word, quiet. And what does that mean, Charlie? Quiet?
Shh, be quiet. Be quiet.
Exactly. So it's an adjective which means to make very little noise or little sound. It's very quiet. You wanted to say quite. So you need to put the E at the end. Quite. Quite attractive.
Good, good.
Not very good. Quite.
It's actually quite a common primary school mistake in native speakers, isn't it, to get that spelling confused. So we understand your error. I also saw a comment about trousers, are or is. Trousers are plural, so we use trousers are, is. Mm. Trousers are. Okay.
Nice.
Let's move on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. One more just before we go. There's a nice comment here. It is useful to use tight trousers in order to move more easily, for example, when jogging or exercising. But I think that kind of gym clothes has a different name. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, what is those gym clothes that are very tight, Charlie?
Lycras.
Lycra.
Lycra is a type of material that yoga people, yogis wear a lot of.
Yeah. So I'll put that on the board. Lycra. Lycra sportswear or something.
Yeah. Sports. Yeah. So just to show everyone the comment, if you can't see it on the replay, women wear skinny jeans and show off their womanly curves. So I don't see a problem that men wear tight trousers. Ooh, nice. I'm not complaining, but I wouldn't be happy to see my boyfriend wearing tight ones. So you've thrown me there. I thought you were on my side, Sonny, and then you suddenly tell me that your boyfriend shouldn't be caught dead in them. There's a phrase, to be caught dead in something.
Mm. To be caught dead in something.
Let me just repeat that. I hope that my boyfriend would not be caught dead in tight trousers.
Yeah.
And Jansen says, I think Harry has won the debate.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, Galina as well. I don't know if it's your Galina from your lessons, but I quite agree with Harry's point of view. But generally, it depends on many factors. Okay, so I'll take this one, Charlie.
There you go. You are the winner of that one. I was trying to find that little sound effects bell, but I couldn't find it.
Oh, man, I was really looking forward to that.
That sounds so bad.
Okay, fantastic. Should we go on to the next one?
Mm-hmm. That caught dead in something. Can you just give another example or explain it?
Yeah. I think this is a phrase actually that we did in one of our previous idioms lessons. So remember to check out that series. So if I see Charlie wearing some hideous trousers or a hideous t-shirt, and I say, Charlie, that's a really nice t-shirt, man. And then I go back home and I say to my mum, because I live with my mum, I say, I wouldn't be seen dead in the t-shirt that Charlie was wearing today. I wouldn't be seen dead in that.
So obviously he was very against that t-shirt of mine. I'm wondering if there's a real t-shirt that you're talking about.
Yeah.
No, but the word there, hideous, hideous. Again, I've put that in the Skype chat. Extreme word, meaning that you detest it, you hate it, it's horrible. Hideous.
Hideous. Yeah. Yeah. So wouldn't be seen dead. We could also use this phrase with places as well, couldn't you, Charlie?
Be caught dead in Detroit.
Yeah, I wouldn't be caught dead there.
Is it you're meaning like a nightclub or something? Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. So you more commonly people would say dead in that bar or that club. If it's very bad and people have negative associations, then you can use that phrase there.
Yeah. Yeah. So if people don't want to be seen in a place because it's not cool, that's quite common. Like in my town, there's some really terrible bars, which I go to. But I could say I wouldn't be caught dead in Yates. This is a really bad bar. I could say I wouldn't be caught there.
Yeah. So we've got a brilliant comment from Anastasis. I didn't know that it was like that. I thought it was Anastasia. Anyway, Anastasis, thank you for that wonderful comment. I wouldn't be caught dead in Lycra.
Ah, nice.
Really nice. I would tend to just say that without leotard. I mean, you can say a leotard. Dead in a Lycra leotard. Yeah, yeah, that's fine.
Very good. Very, very good. Anastasis.
Oh, there you go. Anastasis, thank you.
Cool. So shall we try the next debate topic, seeing as I won that one?
Since you won that, yeah, let's see if I can redeem myself.
Okay, so this is quite a controversial one. I actually want to go for our third one here. Staying single versus getting married. Staying single versus getting married.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, staying single versus getting married. Very controversial one. I like it. Okay. So considering you are single and I am not married, but I am not single, should we take the same position or should we flip it?
I don't mind. You tell me. I'm happy for either.
I'll go with marriage just to keep my lovely girlfriend happy.
Yeah, I think that's probably a wise idea. Okay. So, and remember, you guys, you can write your words that you think are difficult that you want us to use in these debates. And of course, you can offer your opinions as well. And also remember to click subscribe and click the little bell for future lesson reminders. Okay, so I think it's better to stay single so that you can have your freedom. I hear a lot of married people complaining about their lives and the monotony of their lives. And I think if you're single, you have more freedom to do what you want to do instead of thinking about what the other person wants to do. What do you think of that?
Yeah, I like your first attempt. I'm just going to type that word, monotony. Monotony. What does monotony mean, Harry?
So monotony is like when you do not have a variety, when something is tedious or boring, when something is always the same, there is no variety. So I could say, what I hate about marriage is the monotony of it. The monotony. And the adjective, what's the adjective of this?
Monotonous.
Monotonous.
Monotonous. Mm. monotonous. It's quite a difficult word. Yeah, let me just share again. Monotonous. Can you use that in a sentence?
Yes, being married or marriage is monotonous. Married life is monotonous.
To not have variety. So we'd love you guys to try to use that word in whatever conjugation you like and use it within this debate. So you might say that single life is monotonous in a way, or married life. So, we've already got one. I have a monotony job because it's monotonous. I have a monotonous job because it's monotonous. So you're using actually monotony in the incorrect way there, Luca, but really nice try. Why is it incorrect, Harry?
So here you've made a compound noun, so we need to use an adjective to attach to job. I have a monotonous job because it's monotonous. But you could have said, Luca, that I hate the monotony of my job.
Very nice. Very nice. Yeah, I hate the monotony of my job. And the same with Muhammad. My work is monotony. The spelling there, we need another O. But my work is monotonous is the correct answer.
Yeah.
But again, really good usage there. A stream of flings is monotonous.
Oh,
very nice, Alice. So Alice is not a flingy kind of girl. Is that right, Harry?
Yeah, but oh, that's my mother. A stream of flings is monotonous. I hope my mum is not having a go at me there.
That's hilarious.
Yeah. Interesting example there, mummy. My work is monotonous. Yeah, so my work is monotonous. Yeah, so what do you think of that, Charlie? Daniel said it depends on how they're living. You can be a sad married person or a happy single person and vice versa. And of course that's true. Of course that's true. But I think marriage is more monotonous than single life in general. And as our principal aim as humans is to be happy and enjoy our lives, maybe being single is better for that reason. What do you think?
Okay, so I'm actually going to pull from my own experience. I think most of the time we're doing fictitious answers, but in my reality, I feel like single life it has a time and a place. And I think that it's exciting in that time and place, but to drag it out for too long, it becomes monotonous. And as we flow through our life, I think it's a natural process to want to settle down, to want to marry, and to want to find a connection with someone that goes beyond the physical contact, the physical starting exciting moment, and it evolves. It really, really does change, and I'm seeing that in my life. But it's really comforting at the same time, I think.
That's nice. Yeah, maybe I would have a different opinion about it, you know, had I experienced the positive experience that you have had, Charlie.
Maybe.
You said a phrase to drag it out, to drag something out.
I'm glad you spotted that. Yeah. To drag something out is to prolong it, to elongate, to make it longer than it needs to be or than it should be. So if we do this for 2 hours, this lesson, you could probably say, you've dragged it out a bit long, guys. You should finish soon.
Yeah. Yeah. So is it normally has a negative connotation to say to drag something out? So it's extended for too long a period of time.
Yeah, that's really good. Yeah. So it's a negative connotation. Again, so we invite you to try to use these in the comments. The comment box is firing up. So it's really nice to see that you're so active.
Yeah. Should we read some more comments?
Yes, let's.
People now seem that, so Shin has said, people now seem that they don't even mind keep staying single, even though they are in the certain age, many of others getting marriage. Okay, oh, thank you.
Harry, Harry, where are you?
His name is Shin. It's below Daniel Bloodworth.
Shin. Is it quite far up?
It is a little bit, yeah. There's a lot of people commenting.
Okay.
Yeah, my bad. Control F, Shin.
I don't know.
S-H-I-N. Control F, Shin. Anyway, so he said, so just one thing, Shin. People now think, I would say people now think that they don't even mind staying single, even though they are in the, at a certain age, that other people are getting married. So married, to marry, is the verb, to marry. Marriage is the noun. So you could say marriage is interesting, or marriage is monotonous. There we go. Getting married. So you want to say M-A-R-R-I-E-D, getting married. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah.
Here in England, Charlie, what's the normal kind of age to get married here in Britain?
I feel like our generation has pushed the average age up to about 30.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah. Whereas in other countries, it's a lot younger, isn't it?
Even in America, you would think that our cultures are fairly similar, but they're not. In America, people are very keen to get married at mid-20s, maybe even early 20s. And it could be to do with the fact that America is a little bit more religious than England now. Mm. But yeah, they seem to want to get married a bit more than us.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, cool. Should we take the comments down and just maybe debate a bit more with the comments?
Sure, yeah.
Cool.
Okay, so are we carrying on the debate of marriage versus single life?
Yeah, yeah. I've got a comment here from Gabriella, you, my future student, I hope. Staying single is good, as long as you are happy. But when you really fall in love, getting married is just a consequence of living a happy life together. Ooh. Completely true. Yeah,
lovely English as well. Good delivery.
Yeah, it's perfect. Yeah, so I guess your experience, Charlie, is a consequence of just living happily with Stacey, whereas I'm just waiting for that person. So, you know, I may be going back on my debate here. You know, I'm not against marriage, but I don't think it's the end of the world if we don't find that partner that we stay with forever. A lot of people search desperately to find someone. And I think, you know, it either happens or it doesn't happen. And it's not the end of the world if you don't get married.
Okay, I like that. Yeah, yeah. Not the end of the world. Not the end of the world. That's a very, very popular phrase, isn't it?
It is. Where can I write it? Root lining out of space.
So to retort to that, I agree with you that it's important not to pursue happiness and rather to just be happy with what you're doing at the same time. But I do definitely think that if you want that next step in your life. Again, there's a huge amount of responsibility that I'm aware of. Like, it's just building and building and building. And I'm at the stage where I've got barely any responsibility, but I feel like there's too much already.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe if you're a person who doesn't want too much responsibility, then you can avoid marriage. But yeah, it's true. But yeah, it's not the end of the world if you don't find, you know, your partner. But yeah, you've said finding the next step in your life. It really depends on how you perceive these steps and progression in your life. You know, one person might think getting married is their principal aim in life. They may just, they just want to have a wife, or they just want to have a husband. But then another person, their main aim may be money, making lots of money, or traveling the world. So I don't necessarily agree with you that if you want to take your life to the next step in progression, then you need to get married. I disagree.
Okay. Yeah, that's fair. Although I know that you are similar to me, and that we are at the moment finding our career that we really enjoy. We really enjoy teaching, and we want to find a way that it can be our lifelong journey and things like that. Mm. But what's next for you? Once you've discovered this, once you've learned how to have a successful career, what's the next step?
The next step for me is, well, I don't think success doesn't have necessarily an end point. I think it just continues growing. Like, I could say I want to get 100,000 subscribers, but then when I get to 100,000, I want to get to 1 million subscribers. So I just think it's continuous evolution. For me, I would love to find someone who I truly love, but I don't think marriage is my way of showing how much I love them. I think it's more about being with them, showing them complete emotional support, and helping them when they need my help, and being there for them when they need me the most, physically and emotionally.
Okay, so you've touched on quite an interesting point, and we should go over to comments in a moment. But marriage is a questionable thing, because you can cohabit with someone and be perfectly content in that relationship without having the religious celebration. And I agree with that, because I'm not religious, and I see very little point in putting so much effort and energy and stress into one day to celebrate this day. So
absolutely. Shall we have a look at some comments then?
Let's.
So down towards the bottom, Eric has said, one young man asks Socrates, should I get married or should I stay single? Socrates replied, if you ask about it, then in either case, you will regret it.
Okay. Where is that, Harry?
It's above Tang, below Ali Haydar. So my mum said, well said, Eric. So if we can go.
Oh, that's quite far up. So if you can and share the screen, if you've got one, that'd be good in the future.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll work out how to do that.
I think later. It's better. Yeah. Also, pronunciation of, he's actually spelt it with a U, but I know it is in English with an E.
Okay, Socrates. Yeah, Socrates.
Yeah, Socrates, the Greek philosopher. So there, that's what you read, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah. So it's a nice comment. So I guess what Socrates was saying is that if you're asking me, you know, you're obviously having doubts about it, aren't you?
Yeah, so, totally.
Very philosophical answer.
Nice, it's a good one, Eric. Yeah, go to the top of the class.
Yeah. Brandy Vendy.
What's that?
There's one from Brandy Vendy.
Okay, I'll read this one. When you are single, you don't have to deal with a partner who hogs the bed or steals the covers. I'm assuming that, Brandy, you are native, because that is the most native sentence I've read, I think. Really, really, really good language there, and very true. To hog something. Can you explain that, Harry? To hog?
Yeah, to hog. It's to take maybe more than your portion of something, or to invade an amount of space. So if you are hogging the bed, it means you are occupying too much of the bed, right? Hog the bed.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, totally true. And you could hog other things. What could you hog?
Yeah, like in football, you could say he is hogging the ball. And that means you have the ball for too long, you are not passing the ball. So Cristiano Ronaldo is a ball hogger. He hogs the ball. He loves to have the ball at his feet, and he doesn't like passing.
Very true. I remember that was a word that we would always throw around the playground. You hogger. Oh, you're such a hogger.
Yeah, pass it to me. Pass it to me, please.
Yeah. Okay. So the steal the covers, the bed covers. Right. Very nice. Thank you for that, Brandy. If you could let us know if you are native or not, that would be really interesting to hear. Oh, there we go. I'm from the Czech Republic, Prague. Wow.
Amazing.
Kudos on your language ability. Right. Yeah. Should we go for one more?
Uh-huh. I got one from Tarek, that was below Brandy Vendy. I have seen many, many married couple. So here you want to say, I've seen many married couples who have gotten married only for the physical contact and having a baby and starting a monotonous lifestyle. Very nice use of monotonous, Tarek. I like it. I love it.
You love it. Yeah, it's lovable. That's a great usage.
Yeah. So how can we correct that one, Charlie, the sentence in general?
Well, it's informally normal to say many, many sometimes. But if you want to, you can use a stronger modifier. So I have seen a huge amount of married couples. Yeah, married couples with an S who have instead of has got married only for the physical contact and having a baby and starting a monotonous lifestyle. So yeah.
Starting a monotonous lifestyle. Very nice. Very nice. Thank you, Tarek.
Equally as nice as your mother's comment, some animals mate for life like gerbils.
Okay. So she's used the verb to mate there. What does that mean, to mate?
Yeah.
Does that mean they're friends?
All right, mate, how's it going? Yeah, good question. Yeah, so that's a different meaning. It's the biological way of explaining to have sex, to copulate.
That's a nice word. Yeah we often use it when we're talking about the animal kingdom, don't we? The lions were mating in the zoo for 2 hours.
That's a long time, isn't it, Harry?
Yeah, they certainly have more stamina than me.
They're certainly not married yet.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's one thing that apparently goes, doesn't it?
Apparently, yeah.
Perhaps my mum can write a comment about that.
I think you might be surprised, Harry.
Okay, let's a couple, one or two more.
Oh, that was funny. Yeah, we can do. Let's bring the slide back.
At the bottom. Down the bottom.
Yeah. What about this one? Art war.
Okay. I do more prefer marriage life, even though it is the best to be single rather than difficult. Relationship and family, the main point is to be happy where you are. Okay. Can you, it's on my, the camera's on my face, Charlie. Can you make it
Sorry. Yeah, there we go.
Okay.
Yeah, so I do prefer married life, or I do prefer marriage. Either one. I do prefer marriage, or I do prefer married life. Then the next one.
Even though it is the best... It is better to be single
better
rather than having a difficult relationship or a difficult relationship and family. The main point is to be happy where you are. Very nice. Thank you, Art War. I like that. I agree.
Yeah. Okay. So now we probably should come to the end of that debate. So send in whether you think Harry, who was leading the single life, or Charlie, who is supporting marriage, who was correct? And also take into account the comments. I think the comments led that one, didn't they?
Absolutely. Yeah, really interesting comments, guys. Thank you very much for offering them to us.
And you're using your English so actively. It's brilliant. It's really, really exciting to see. We're helping so many people. Oh, my God.
Yeah, and they're helping us as well, which is a beautiful two-way relationship. So thank you, everyone, for participating so well.
Yeah, win-win indeed. Okay, so Galina's on my side. Thank you, Galina. Agree with Sunny's idea. Ah, oh, Sunny's idea. Yeah, I remember reading that out, but I can't remember exactly.
Galina's Art War, I like your delivery. Yeah, I liked Art War's delivery as well. It's very good. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So Gabriella is on your side. Gabriella's saying Harry wins.
Of course. But there we go. Yeah.
Let's move on. So thank you so much for that. Let's what should we, Harry?
Sorry?
One more debate.
Let's do a quick one.
Yeah, a quick one. Okay, so we're moving on to the next debate. So you chose that one. Okay, I've got a good one. So I'm going to share my screen. And the debate: should dating techniques be taught in school? Should dating techniques be taught in school? I think we need to flip for this one, don't we?
Yeah.
Your right hand.
Correct. Right.
Oy! So we didn't decide who was what. Maybe
also,
the mid is four.
I'll just give you a clap for winning that one, Charlie. So well done. And this is for me.
Apparently. Thanks so much. Yeah. This is.
Okay. Right. Next one.
Should dating techniques be taught in school? So I'm for that. Yeah. So lid means four. So I will start by saying absolutely they should be. It's probably one of the most important topics that they have forgotten.
What are you talking about? That's obscene. No, I don't agree with that. No, it's ridiculous. I mean, how would they create a syllabus for this? So would they have dating techniques for simply trying to achieve sex, dating activities for people who want to meet a have a serious relationship? How would they define their curriculum? I think
that's the beautiful thing. Within the syllabus, they can educate people how to treat each other respectfully, so they don't end up just going about and hurting each other. So they can also, along the way, they can teach them, ways to approach each other and be, as I said, respectful. I haven't got another thought yet.
Yeah, that's I see where you are going, Charlie. I see where you are going, but I think it's ridiculous. I mean, Didrik has said it depends on how old the students are. True, that's a very good point, Didrik. Thank you. Because if these kids are like, 10 years old, we can't be teaching them how to date. And, you know, what if the kids learn how to make people like them, and then they take advantage of men and women and young men and women using these new skills that they've learnt in class? I think it could be risky.
No, I disagree. I'm going to go a little bit extreme here, but I'm going to say that sex is such a taboo comment or a taboo topic that it us feel like it's an unnatural process. And although I'm not promoting doing it at such a young age, but leading them into understanding how mothers and fathers create a relationship at a younger age will help them to understand what comes next. So for the next step, and they understand it rather than suddenly 16, 17, 18, bam, they're like, oh, okay, I should find someone. What do I do? What do I do, Harry?
Well, like anything, you learn by doing. You learn just by doing, not by learning it in the classroom.
Well, that could say, why do we have any theoretical, like, subjects if it's just by doing?
Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah, I just think there's no point in school.
Okay. So I'm going to hold you to that. Harry doesn't think it's important to go to school. Who's on my side?
No, I think there's more interesting schools. There's types of schools like free schools, they're called, and they don't have the kind of set curriculums that are determined by the government, and they teach more practical skills. I think schooling should be more like that. But perhaps there would be a place for dating classes in a free school like that. So, you know, it could work. It could work, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe...
I think you're talking about Montessori schools learning.
Ah, okay, Montessori schools.
Yeah. I don't really know if I can spell that. Anyway, we've got some comments from quite a few people because it's quite a controversial one. We've got a comment from Galina. She liked what I said. Thank you, Galina Vlast. Shin, difficult point, I think, is to teach how to date necessarily to understand what actually dating means, why you need to be taught about it, why it's not needed. Okay, thank you for that point. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. So my mum said it could be part of sex education. So maybe we could integrate it into sex education classes. That could be interesting.
But don't you think, Harry, that our sex education is really, really bad and it's just such a strange approach that they take?
It is awful. Yeah. How to put a condom on a banana.
Yeah, it's just the furthest thing that you need to understand. They need to teach you about how to make actual friendships with girls, or, you know, how to talk to another person who's of the opposite sex. I think that's way more important, especially if it's an all one gender or not a mixed school.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true. Yeah, I know it is important. I mean, you're winning me over. You're winning me over.
To win someone over. To win someone over. And what does that mean?
To win someone over means to maybe change someone's opinion about something. If, you know, my original side of the debate was that it shouldn't be integrated into schools. But now he has won me over, or he is winning me over, and now I am changing my opinion. So Charlie is winning me over.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think we need to leave it there. I think I've got students. I mean,
so really quickly, who won this debate, guys?
Charlie won. Well, you were won over by me, so surely I won.
Yeah, I'll give you that. Okay, I'll give you that, Charlie.
It's so pathetic, that clap. Okay, thank you so much, everybody. You've been amazingly active in the comment section, which we are here for. So you've served our purpose. Thank you so much. We actually do one-to-one private lessons. If you wanted to get active speaking the language and learning even quicker, then look at our links in the description below to see our websites.
Exactly. And remember to join us on Facebook at Real English with Real Teachers, and to follow us on Twitter at Real English 16. And when you click subscribe, you will get and then hit the little bell on the YouTube channel, you will get notifications every time we go live every Wednesday at 12 p.m. midday London time. So remember to hit subscribe and click the bell.
Absolutely. Also, if you're looking for a way to improve your self-study on your own, then I've got an ebook along with an audio guide that really gives you a powerful exercise to improve that self-study. So go ahead and get that in the description box. We've also got a few more pieces of information in the description box. So if you have not seen that, go ahead and scroll down to that section for us. I'm still trying to find the random selection for our prize draw.
Cool. I'll just add one last thing while you're searching for that. Tell us what you thought of this episode, because doing debates is new for us on these live lessons. Normally we do idioms, but we like to give a variety so that our classes are not monotonous. So tell us what you thought of this lesson. Remember to hit the thumbs up so that YouTube know that we're doing good things and they rank us higher. And tell us what you think and what you would like to see from future lessons from us.
Absolutely. So without further ado, I shall reveal the randomly selected prize draw winner. Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm actually getting a number from my phone, and you're all on a different number, allocated a different number. Okay. All right, so number 10. That doesn't seem very random. 10. Okay, so we have Merv. You are our winner today. M-E-R-V-E.
Fantastic, Merv. We will be in contact with you. We will send you an email and details on how to book your free lesson with Chaz and I.
There you go. Thank you very much. I hope that you enjoy your prize. And of course, this goes every 2 weeks. So if you didn't win this time, you might be luckier next time. So yeah, you can enter again. All right. Anything else to say?
No, that's all. See you next Wednesday. Thank you very much, everyone. It's been a real pleasure. We've really enjoyed it. So see you soon.
See you soon, guys. And I might be wearing tight trousers next time.
Oh, God. I look forward to that, Charlie.
All right. Okay. All right. Bye, everyone. And see you, Harry.
See you later. Bye.